happeningweekdaychurch.com. We're going to continue the story that we were doing yesterday from Matthew 24, verses 9 through 13. If you did not watch yesterday's, go watch it before you're watching today. It's the start of the message. This is just part two. Heavenly Father, we do pray that you'll prepare our hearts for the words that you have for us. Give us soft hearts made of flesh and not hard hearts made of stone. Don't give us an argumentative spirit because, well, we've already heard something we like better. God, give us a spirit of listening and discernment to understand what you're saying to us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our opening song today is People Get Ready by Crystal Lewis. I hope you like the song, and I'll see you right after it's over.
Lord, I'm ready now. I'm waiting for your triumph fairy tale. You're coming so soon. This world has nothing for me. I find my peace and joy. So
verses 9 through 14. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come. Jesus is answering their questions that they asked way back in verse 3 of what's it going to be like when Jesus returns? What's it going to be like at the close of the age? You know, what are the signs of this? What's going to be happening? What's going to be going on? And Jesus is explaining at this point what the church, see that in verse 9, those who are in, this is all happening because you believe in his name. This is happening for his name's sake. What the church will be going through. We talked about yesterday the persecutions, that they would be hated in all nations, persecuted, delivered and imprisoned, martyred, that this would happen in all nations. We will not be an exception. But not only will those things happen in all nations, the same in all nations will be some of these other traits that you'll start seeing in the church. And I want to talk about those. In the church, you will see what is called the great apostasy, the falling away of many from church. That would be an enormous thing in our Western cultures. We've already seen it happening, or that it's happened in Europe, where the church had grown so much, where it was so strong, where it was the Holy Roman Empire, where the church really had just pretty much ruled Europe. It has dwindled to the point where hardly anyone even attends church anymore. Not only is it not a Christian, it is very post-Christian, and in some places becoming anti-Christian in Europe. We don't want to think that that is happening in America, but it is. Look at the typical church. You may go to a different church, and we will talk about some of those in a minute and as we go forward next week. But look at the typical church. The average size of the church is 70 to 75 people on a given Sunday. We like to think, because so many of us have visited or attended these mega churches, that the average church runs hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. It is not the typical church. The typical church runs 70 to 75 people. That's average. When you put in all these mega churches, then how many are there under 70 to 75 people in a given week? Well, lots of them. And most of these places, even a lot of the mega churches today, are gray. They are very old. There are 500 bajillion churches that you could walk into in North America and look and say, if something doesn't change, this church won't be here in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. You'll look up and say, there's no way they could exist. Almost everyone here would be dead or so old that they couldn't maintain this church anymore. There's just no one young coming here. Why? Because of a great falling away. Very few people, 45 and under, go to church. And you can say, well, my church is the exception. So many people go that are young to my church. Well, that's great. I hope it is. And we need to have churches where young people are going to church. But it's the exception that proves the rule as you look around. Once the boomers pass on, you will look and see a post-Christian pagan country with very few people going to church, and it will not look like the America many of us remember. It will start looking much more like Europe. Not only will there be a great falling away, some of these things will happen, and there will be other results in the church. There will be, it says, betrayal in the church, that they will fall away. Many will fall away from what? From the church. They will betray one another and hate one another. If you've went to church before, you know how this is. This is not going to surprise you that people will stab you in the back at church, and that there is a lot of hate, splits, divisions, fights in the church. And not just denomination to denomination, but even amongst local churches. That one local church will think badly of another one, yes, but even in its own church, that its own people will be stabbing each other in the back, looking for something, wanting to be in power, arguing, fighting, splitting, hating each other. You know, Jesus said that they would know we are Christians by the love we have for one another. So many people say, I don't want to go to church today. Why have we seen some of this great falling away? Because people have looked in the church and not seen that very Christian thing that he said that we had to see to be a Christian church, which is our love for one another. You can go into many churches and see that a lot of the people there can't stand somebody else in that place. That is the opposite of what church is supposed to be. So no wonder we're seeing a great falling away. If that is the church, then it's not a church. If we are not in love with God, and we are not in love with each other, we are not a church. We can call ourselves whatever we want. We can play church, but we are not a church. Not only will there be betrayal and hate in the church, there will be other problems in the church. There will be false prophets and false teachers. This will be throughout the church. Beyond this, you even see that it's a little more than that. False teachings and seducing spirits and a great falling away. That these things will happen. And we'll talk some more about these as we go into the next week. But that there will be all this false teaching and false teachers in the church. And that's some of what we'll start with next week. There will be this libertine idea, which is one of those false teachings. And I'm only mentioning it because it is right here. That this idea of I can do anything and still call myself a Christian. This idea of lawlessness. Of I can just run around and act however I want and still say I'm a Christian. But that's not true, and it's not the way it works. And that is sweeping through the church today of this idea of, well, you know, we don't have to say anything, or we're not going to get on anybody, because if we did, they'd leave the church. Because of this great falling away, it is becoming a cycle. The falling away and the itching ears leads to the false teachers who just want to keep their organization going, who no longer say anything to anybody, no longer speak like a pastor, no longer speak like a prophet, no longer discipline the people or bring out the rod of correction and say this must stop, this is wrong, this is sin. In fact, they just back off and we just talk about the nice things and the light things. We talk about salvation without ever talking to anybody why they need salvation. So it doesn't even make sense. We talk about the good news, but we don't know why it's good news that Jesus had to die on the cross. We just think it sounds brutal because we don't want to talk about how sinful and desperately we needed salvation. And on it goes, this libertine idea from the pulpit to the pew. It says that we would be loveless, as we talked about before with the betrayal and the hate, that because of a wickedness, we'd be loveless. And that there are good things, though, too. And I want to finish the week on these. I want you to catch these good things. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. There will be strength, too. In the last church, as many have faded away, as many are loveless, as many have itching ears, there will always be a remnant who will stand firm to the very end. They will not be shaken. They will not be moved. They will stand up for God. And not only will they stand up for God, the last church will be very evangelistic. The gospel will be preached in every nation, in every kingdom, to every tribe and tongue. They will hear God. And there will be people in heaven from every nation, tribe, and tongue because of these last days' evangelistic efforts. And not by one person like Billy Graham, although he's done a great job, but by the entire church that we will go out and those that have stood firm to the end will be sharing Christ. But what we see at most churches today, and if you go to one of those mega churches and you can easily think, you know, well, we're very different. We will be talking about that some next week. But the typical mega church has grown on the backs of these smaller churches that are dying. It doesn't mean they're terrible for doing it, but it's not typically evangelistic growth of going out and finding those who don't go to church and getting them in. Many of them are growing just because they offer more programs than the churches that are smaller around the corner and people go there. We will be talking about some of those signs next week and what that means to the church and what we need to do. And we will continue this teaching as we go forward. Thank you so much for joining us. Again, if you have any questions, please write. Please send them to me. I'm happy to answer.